Well, good morning. And welcome to worship at St. Andrew's, an inclusive and affirming church located in downtown North Bay. We are delighted that you've decided to join us this morning. I know some of you had to do some fairly heavy scraping of cars. I was not prepared for that this morning. But whether you're here in person or whether you're joining us later online, welcome. We hope that this time of worship together will be a blessing to you. As always, there are some announcements about the life and work of the church, and those are wonderfully laid out in our Together news sheet, and I thank Janet Ross and Derek Stott for putting that together for us each week, and to Derek for making sure that it's up on the website. But there are some announcements that I really feel need some extra attention, so I would draw your attention to them now. As always, your turkey fest soup is at the back behind my best customer, Monique Peters, on that back table. Today is So Together Sunday, and you are invited to gather in the club room after refreshments. And thank you to Liz Westbrook and Betty Hurley for providing our treats today. So for a time to sew polar fleece mittens, and I just want to show you what Betty Hurley has been doing. So here are Betty's, and I love these. I love these mitts. Right team. Perfect team. I have been a loyal fan since my dad and I watched Hockey Night in Canada when I was a little kid. So these are wonderful. So this is the kind of thing that we're going to be doing. So thanks, Betty, for bringing those along for us. So Donna Landry's got us all organized, and she has tasks for all of us, even those of us who are not able to sew. So please come on down after refreshments. It's going to be great, great fun. This week's Star Word activity can be found in the Together sheet. We've become aware of some new Star Word related outreach that's happening in the congregation. We hope that your Star Words are enriching your daily spiritual life. Next week, January 29, brings us to our first fifth Sunday and our first gathered worship at Emmanuel United Church on Lakeshore Drive. A detailed invitation from those folks appears on the last page of the Together sheet. Please note, though, that Emmanuel's masking policy requires that your mask remain on throughout worship, and during the time that you are picking up your food in the luncheon afterwards, and then your mask can come off. So their policy is just slightly different from ours. I would really encourage you to attend if you're able. It's a great opportunity to mingle with folks that we don't see very often. So, and just a reminder that our church will be closed as a result next Sunday. You will find details about Bonnie Houston's Celebration of Life, which takes place 2 weeks from today, February the 5th, on Sunday afternoon at the Mother House. And in the same vein, I'm sorry to tell you that we received a phone call from Doris Cole yesterday morning to say that George passed into spirit on Friday night. You will remember George as a cheerful, fun-loving guy. He, for years, along with Dave O'Neill, was our turkey travel agent. Just a wonderful guy, and we mourn with the Cole family. We're thinking the reception will be on Wednesday afternoon. That is not yet firmly established, but you'll be notified in a congregational email for the final date on that. And just a reminder that for any of you who are interested in offering a special prayer, there are still star prayer cards available at the back of the sanctuary. if you wish to use those for folks that you're really concerned about. And the one last announcement, I would ask you to take note of a planned congregational meeting to be held after worship 3 weeks from today. That would be February the 12th. And the purpose of that congregational meeting is to entertain and approve a revision to the parameters that were set out last fall for our search team. And the exact wording of that motion can be found in the middle of page 3 on your together sheet. I would welcome Pat Curtin Bailey this morning to lead us in worship. But before she joins us, I'm going to offer the land acknowledgement, and we're going to light some candles. And Malcolm and Aidan are going to help me with that in just a second. We acknowledge that for hundreds of years, the land on which we are so very privileged to worship has been inhabited by the Anishinaabe peoples of the Nipissing First Nation. The Creator gifted the lands to the peoples and guided them to work together, live together in peace and harmony with all its inhabitants. We are grateful for their stewardship, and we pledge to open our hearts as we walk with our Indigenous sisters and brothers toward true reconciliation and right relations. And these wonderful folks are going to help me light the candles. So here you go. So we light our Christ candle. So that's our tall candle, Aidan. We light our Christ candle. There you go. If you can light that one for us right here. Just take it over. Take it over. Yeah. And you can just put the flame right up here, right there. Yeah. Good. Good. Excellent. Okay. And then pass that on to Malcolm. So we light our Christ candle as the spirit of the symbol among us, and then our community candle. Malcolm's going to light that. Thank you, Malcolm, and you can blow that out now. Thank you so much. Perfect. Thank you. And our community candle as a reminder of our commitment to live in love and harmony with all peoples. Pat.
Thank you, Liz and Malcolm and Aidan, for that help this morning. And please join me in the call to worship as printed in your bulletin or on the screen. O Lord, when I cry aloud, be gracious to me and understand me. Come, my heart says, seek his face.
Your face, Lord, do I see.
Do not turn your servant away in anger. You have been. Do not cast me off. Do not forsake me, O God, my salvation. And please join us in hymn 235, O Worship the King.
Worship the
Join me in the gathering prayer. It's going to be followed by the Lord's Prayer, the sung version, Voices United 959. Parent God, you are our salvation. In your holy name we have gathered. We come before you, loving Mother, to offer our praise and thanksgiving. We thank you for watching over us and guiding us with your love. Please continue to guide us and lead us along the path you have set before us. Loving Parent God, please guide us and protect us that we may learn from you. Please share your wisdom and knowledge as we face the challenges of life. Help us to see the light in this wondrous world you have put into our care, and give us the strength and wisdom to live up to this challenge. We pray these things in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, and as we sing together now. All remember that the light is with us, the Spirit surrounds us with love and cares for us. And now I'm going to ask the children and any of those young at heart who would like to join me at the front for our children's time. So let's go fishing. No one go fishing? I'm sure you've all gone fishing before. You've probably gone fishing with a fishing rod and a scoop net to catch the fish, and of course some bait. Bait always helps. But we're going to talk about some fishing that people did a long time ago.
What type of fishing?
The type of fishing that Jesus did at Jesus' time. And they used to use a net, like this. Okay? And they'd toss that net into the seas,
And the fish would swim into the net. Sometimes they get their gills caught in them. Now, just to remind everybody, you can't fish with a net today. This is not allowed, so don't try it. But back in Jesus' time, there was more fish, so they could use a fish net. So, one day, Jesus was walking on the shore, and he saw two brothers, and he turned to these two brothers, and he said, "Come with me, and we will fish from people." Yeah, that's kind of strange, isn't it? We're going to fish for people. But they dropped their nets, and they went with Jesus. And he went down the shore a little further, and he saw some other people, two sons fishing with their father, and he said to the sons, "Come with me, and we're going to fish for people." And they left their father, left their nets, and they went with Jesus. And they were going to fish for people. Now, I don't know. I don't understand. What do you think they were doing? Do you think when they were fishing for people, they could, like, do this? And they caught the people. No, maybe that's not what they did. Oh, we lost one fish there. No. I don't think that's what they were doing. But thinking of that, can people think of how we could fish for people today? How can we bring people? Yeah, but we're looking for people. So do we have any ideas? Anybody, anywhere, ideas on how we could fish for people? How we could bring people back into the fold, as they say? Let people remember the grace of God, the light
offer
of God?
Offer cookies and goodies after service.
Okay. Yes, I'm sure. Any other ideas?
Kindness.
Bring them with you, yes. Kindness. That is a great idea, kindness. Any other ideas? I'm sorry? Be a good example. Great. That's wonderful.
Let people know that we miss them and that our community is not complete without them.
Do watermelons grow on trees? Do what? Watermelons? I don't think so. I think they grow on vines. Okay, so I am going to ask people, everybody got a fish? So I want you to take that fish and I want you to write on it a way that you think you can fish for people. And once you've written on it, Malcolm, can you help me with this? I want you to bring the fish up and we're going to put them on the fish net. So can you come over here? Go over to that end of the table and take behind the mic. Mm-hmm. Just on the end of the table.
So is it in common fish for people?
Yeah.
Kindness.
If you ask the Lord, you can do it. So once you've got it done, if you can just bring your, whoops, a little too close there. If you can bring your fish up and just hang them on the fish net. So right, how you can fish for people.
Okay.
Ask Liz.
Kindness, sure, I can bring kindness.
Excuse me, Aiden, so I'm gonna step forward. I don't wanna step on you.
Stick it in like this?
Yeah, stick the gills into the net. Perfect.
Just if we need them.
No.
Alright?
Just stick the gills into the net.
Just stick the gills in. That's why she's happy there.
Come in the middle, please.
There we go.
Okay.
a large boat something.
Large boat something.
Yeah. Large boat something.
Easier then. There you go.
What to say in these days.
All right.
Well, it looks like we're very good fisher people. I'm going to leave everyone with a challenge this week to remember what you've written on the net and to go out and fish for people. Thank you. Oh, we're going to do a prayer. And please repeat after me. Sorry, my fingers don't always work. Let us pray. Loving God, thank you for the love of Jesus.
Thank you for the love of Jesus.
Help us to be fishers of people.
Help us to be fishers of people.
Help us spread the light of God.
Help us spread the light of God.
We love you, God.
We love you, God.
And feel your love. In
Jesus'
name, amen.
In
Jesus' name. Amen.
Oops. A reading from Isaiah 9. But there will be no gloom for those who are in anguish. In the former time, he brought into contempt the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, but in the later time he will make glorious the way of the sea, the land beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the nations. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in the land of a deep darkness, on them light has shined. You have multiplied exultation. You have increased joy. They rejoice before you, as with joy at the harvest, as people exult when dividing plunder. For the yoke of their burden and the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor, you have broken as on the day of Midian. And the second reading is from Matthew. Now when Jesus heard that John had been arrested, he withdrew to Galilee. He left Nazareth and made his home in Capernaum, by the sea, in the territory of Zebulun and Naphtali. So that what had been spoken through the prophet Isaiah might be fulfilled. Land of Zebulun, land of Naphtali, on the road by the sea, across the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. The people who sat in darkness have seen a great light. And for those who sat in the region and shadow of death, light has dawned. From that time, Jesus began to proclaim, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near." As he walked by the Sea of Galilee, Jesus saw two brothers, Simon, who is called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishers. And he said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fishers of people." Immediately they left their nets and followed him. And he went from there, and as he went from there, he saw two brothers, James, the son of Zebedee, and his brother John, in their boat with their father Zebedee, mending their nets, and he called them. Immediately they left their boat and their father and followed him. Jesus went through all Galilee, teaching in their synagogues, and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and curing every disease and every sickness among the people. These words are offered as wisdom for our journey.
Let us walk together in their truth.
Please join us in singing hymns 563, Jesus, You Have Come to the Lakeshore.
Let us pray. Loving parent, we pray you speak in this place, in the calming of our minds and in the longing of our hearts. Holy One, may the words of my lips and the thoughts that we form be acceptable to you. Amen. Let there always be light. There always has been. In Isaiah, the reference to God bringing light to the darkness, in a world of foreign powers and foreign ways, comes a shining light. This light does not come from those foreign powers or even from the people's efforts.
It was God alone that delivered the people from the darkness into the light. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light was drawn. In Psalm 27, King David discusses the issue of faith in the midst of fear, seeking the face of God, and waiting on God in the midst of life's difficulties. The Lord is my light and my salvation. In Matthew, the people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Why have we returned to these words from Isaiah? Because our gospel reading from Matthew quotes them. We come back to this passage from Isaiah and are reminded that in Jesus we have seen a great light. Epiphany is a time of God's breaking into human history. The powers of the world are unmasked, revealed to be sham for all their bluster and posturing. Through Jesus Christ, God shows the fairness, the falseness of worldly powers that claim so much authority in our lives. They do not have the last word. The image of light is such a powerful one, one that we can all recognize. We have all been in the dark and experienced the blinding of the light. In Isaiah and in Psalm 27, and again in Matthew, the Lord calls light because light drives away the darkness. Because our accepting Lord always drives away the darkness. Our Mother, Father, God is always with us, always fanning a spark, so that we can feel the light of the Spirit within us and around us. Light is used as to symbolize God, faith, and holiness throughout the Scriptures. As Christians, we are called to not only walk in the light, but to be the light for others. There are many references to light in the Bible, starting with Genesis 1, 3, and 4. God said, "Let there be light," so there was light. God saw the light, was beautiful. He separated the light from the darkness. And ending with Revelations 21, 23, "And the city has no need of sun or moon to shine on it, because the glory of God illuminates the city, and the Lamb is its lamp." The city does not need the sun or the moon to shine on it, for the glory of God gives it light, and the Lamb is its lamp. In the Old Testament, there are 177 references to light, and in the New Testament, there are 75 references. I did suggest to Stuart that I could solve the problem of my sermons being too short by reading all 252 passages. But I'm not sure that would be that enlightening. Still, it is significant to remember the importance of light in our lives, the importance of the light of the Lord in our lives. Over 2,000 years later, we are still looking to the light, still feeling the light of our accepting Father, Mother, God, surrounding us with love. Jesus is the light of the world. He spreads the light. He calls us to help spread the light, to become fishers of people. There are so many ways that we can keep the light in the world. We let the Spirit shine within ourselves by taking time to visit with those who are unable to come out and visit us. Let the Spirit shine by taking time with our children. Don't disregard their feelings and ideas offhand. We can learn so much from them. We let the Spirit shine within ourselves when we show acceptance of others, when we hold out a helping hand to those in need. And this doesn't just mean in a monetary way, which is very important,
But it is equally as important to take time to talk to people, to get to know them, to know their stories, to let the light shine. Let the light of the world shine by taking care of this wonderful world that the Lord has given us. It needs to heal, and we must take the responsibility for that healing. Someone said to me recently, what good do you really think it will do just because you don't buy laundry detergent in plastic bottles? Well, I haven't for about 4 years now. I figure that if I can convince one other person to stop buying laundry detergent in plastic bottles, and they convince one other person to stop buying laundry in plastic bottles, eventually people will stop making laundry detergent in plastic bottles, and it will keep it out of our oceans and our seas and our landfills. And this is a way that we can make the light shine, make our world healthy again. Change isn't going to be easy, and it isn't going to be fast, but it is possible with a little bit of faith. The light will shine through. The Spirit of the Lord is with us, around us, caring for us, guiding us. We just have to listen and watch the light. Please open yourselves to the love and miracles offered to us every day by our great Creator. Keep the light of the Lord shining so others can find their way. Amen. Music.
Center, daylight or darkness.
And now it's time for our offering, and as Doug brings the offering forward.
What can I do? What can I sing? What can I say? What can I sing? I'll sing with joy. I'll say a prayer.
If you could join me in our offering dedication. Nurturing God, we bring our offerings of time, talent, and money. We strive to give back to you from the abundance blessings you have given us. May our gifts be acceptable in your spirit, and may they be used for your work, O Lord, our God. Amen.
Whoops, I think I dropped a fish. Please pray with me. Dear Creator God, we come to you this morning, mid-January, some of us in a dark place, sick, lonely, feeling rejected, grieving, struggling to keep ourselves going. The Christmas lights are gone, except the few we have here. I'm grateful for them. The days are short, with little or no sun. But we know the days are getting longer, and we anticipate spring. Thank God for hope. We are grateful for our church family. Let all be a reflection of your light, displayed in a phone call, a card, a friendly word, or just a kind smile. Thank you for the church staff, the board members, the search committee, and all the other volunteers for helping us to live our mission and bring a welcome beacon of light in our downtown neighborhood. The news is riddled with tragedy. The war in Ukraine, global warming, drugs, people without homes, food insecurity, the rising cost of living, unsafe environments, accidents, guns, and on and on. Help us, God, to be aware of those suffering from the effects of any of these, and awaken us to ways that we can be involved, that we can help others who need us to be their voice. We often feel overwhelmed, but we can still be a light and a support in our small corner of the universe. Make us mindful of our neighbors in need. This morning we pray for those we hold dear in our heart. Think of Doris Cole and her family.
Bob, Christy, and Dave.
Mark, Brian.
Helga.
And the team to go left.
Bruce.
Jeremy.
God, as we go into this new week, let us go with a new spring in our step and a smile on our face reflecting God's light, and make us mindful of the snow and the joy of people playing in the outdoors, fishing, skiing, walking with a friend and having a laugh, or planning a vacation. Thank you, God, for winter. God, hear our prayer. Amen. And our next hymn is Voices United, 679, Let There Be Light.
You may be seated. I want to thank the people who make this Sunday possible for us, to Liz and Ralph and our wonderful choir, and Kim and Liz, the other Liz, Derek, for doing our filming. They work so hard, and they do such a wonderful job. Reminder that there are refreshments in the chapel after service, and then downstairs in the club room, if you want to help to make mitts, please join us. Please join me in ascending forth. Let us go forth from this place with thankful hearts and joyful spirits, and let us continue to share God's gifts and ours abundantly. Amen.